Sticky Fingers is one of those albums spread around, you know, different continents, different, slightly different times. So it doesn't have that, oh, we were in the studio for, you know, 2 years making Sticky Fingers.
Yeah, we were growing up and been listening to a lot more music and played with a lot more different people and, I mean, experience, I suppose. I suppose around that time we were starting, without knowing it, to... for that experience to start to show in its way. It's quite a mature album in its way, you know.
Describe the cover. I can't even remember it. What is the cover?
The cover is a picture of a guy's denim jeans, just this part here and here. And Andy Warhol designed it, and it has originally on the original vinyl, it had a zipper on it.
What, who's got it? It's got to be Mick, right? Is it?
So I got the phone call and they said, Corey, come over now. And I walked across Union Square, got into the elevator, went up onto the 7th floor to the factory. The doors opened. I came in. I'm ready. Okay, Andy Warhol is ready for you. But wasn't that formal? You know, let me back up. I was just like, here I am. Let's go. Andy W. took me to where the photograph was going to be, the Polaroid thing. You know, he had a handheld Polaroid, no tripod, you know, around his neck, you know, that kind of thing, and done. Obviously, it's an image that anyone could claim because there's no identity other than anatomical identity.
I no one really knows whose crotch is depicted in the Andy picture. I always thought it was Joe D'Alessandro, but Joe D'Alessandro always modelled nude for Andy, right?
They all talked about me because I was the one that was, you know, looked at as the sweetheart of the factory. Everybody wanted to be me. Why can't we be Joe? You know, I didn't do anything to be Joe, I just was. There's another guy that talks about it all the time, that it's him, that he did the photo shoot for this. His name's Corey. I had a talk with him once, and I said, he told me he had the same belt. If I had that belt, he had the same one. I said, well, that's nice, you know. I can't fight with people over it. And I was the person that let people in and out of the factory. So if I didn't see you, you probably weren't there. Oh, what I was going to come over and say, the only reason I'm saying it's me because I can get a couple of tickets to the show. Wild Horse is probably one of the best collaborations between Mick and me. We were doing overdubs in Mick's house in the country, and for some reason I remember leaving the studio with the smell and damp English. And then I had to drive like 200 miles or something, and I was just cruising all the way. But I remember, for some reason, I remember leaving that session. You know, I was still like, wow.
There's a lot of references to drugs in the album, and I just wondered.
Did you notice that? Yeah. It's pretty much soaked in any drug you can think of, the whole album, especially as far as I'm concerned.
I guess it's the 10 best songs you had. You stuck them on, you know, we stick them on in the studio mixing room, which I think was somewhere in LA, and we stuck them all on the board and said, oh, that's good, we've got to have that one, we've got to have that one, we've got to have that one. And I don't know how much real thought went into looking at it as a whole. I'm sure we played it all through and say, oh, it's amazing, we're so great. But, and then never played it again. And then, who knows? I mean, it's strange when you think about it, because we did have a lot of other songs. And if I'm looking at it now, I say, well, why would you put System Morphine on? You've got enough down songs. Why would put such a down a song on there? You've got all these ballads like Wild Horses and I Got the Blues, it's enough.
Yeah, Mick Jagger would tell you there's a lot of slow songs on here, and he's a bit apprehensive about that, but I'm not.
Why not?
Because they make it anyway. They've still got a little kick.
System Morphine and Moonlight Mile, for instance, we very rarely have played on stage. And that's kind of eerie in a way, because in a way you're suddenly back in the studio in 1970 or something, you know. I mean, you can't help it, just sort of, then you have to look around and make sure where you are and check you've got grey hair, you know.
We recorded this in my house in the country, and it was like one of these kind of faux minstrel gallery type, big Victorian hall, you know, in an imitation of medieval. And they, Jim Price and Bobby Keys were in the on the top. I can't really, why they're up there. We all had these strange notions of where people should be then. But anyway, so I remember them rehearsing their part up there, like, and I was like really working them really hard. And Keith told me, don't work them so hard. I said, well, you know, they seem to want to do it, you know, and they just were playing this part over and over and over and over. And they really got it down.
Very, very professional when working Bobby Keys. You have to be in this game, you know, but the minute work was finished, that was another story. That guy could relax quicker than anybody I knew, and bless his heart.
Well, Bobby was the best, he was the best rock and roll saxophone player. You know, Bobby never pretended and wasn't Sonny Stitt or, you know, he wasn't Charlie Parker. He never pretended to be, but he was the best at what he did. Miss him, actually. Miss him a lot.
I'm sure I'll be, as I was on the last tour, I expect to turn round to my left to see Bobby Keys. You know, I mean, it's like, you know, de rigueur. But, I'm trying to get used to that. But we've got a great new guy, Carl, who's also a big fan of Bobby Keys, so that helps. And, that song, great horn parts. Anyway, Jim Price and Bobby, they're best. Good rocker.
Are there any that you're apprehensive about playing?
Yeah, all of them. Especially I'm apprehensive about every intro, every arrangement, and every solo. But apart from that, it's a breeze.
I mean, there are songs that are fantastic. If they come off, are great to play, you know. Can't You Hear Me Knocking's one. If that works, it's great.
The parts seemed tailor-made for me. And I've known Mick for many years, Taylor, and the way he plays Can't You Hear Me Knocking, I will stick quite a lot to the melody that Mick Taylor laid. And the arrangement that the boys laid down, you know, it just goes without saying that that's the way I play it, with a great amount of respect.
It started off, I remember, it was just, you know, the vocal part, the first part of the song, that was supposed to be it.
The sort of Latin, vaguely Latin jazz second half was not really planned, I don't think.
We don't usually go that open, but doesn't mean to say we can't.
I think that's a good moment for the Stones to be, like, going into something that they're not really, is not really their territory, but we'll go anyway. You know, it's kind of quite brave, really, to do that. I like the Rolling Stones when they try things that they, not really them, and then it comes off, you know. Even if it doesn't come off, it's good marks for trying, I think.
It's a chance to groove, but Mr. Jagger will go, don't let it go on too long, all right? But it's very funny, but we kind of tease him and go, well, I'm going to play a bit more then. Oi. Yeah. And I say, well, what about harmonica solo? And he goes, nobody wants to hear that. I got the blues. Once again, that's a lesson in how to be in control or hold it down. You've got to hold that song.
That is probably the slowest song we've ever recorded. At first, I was, this is very slow, and Mick was looking at me too, thinking the same thing, I know. As we got into it, this is one of the charms of it, is that slowness, because it builds up so nice, and once again, great horn parts. And I'm really interested in that one.
And you never know if that's going to work until you get to the end. That's a bugger to hold down the tempo.
To play something that slow is going to be... Well, it's going to be interesting.
Brown Sugar, yeah. Reminds me, I was sitting in a field in Australia with a pair of headphones on, plugged into my electric guitar and writing this tune while I was shooting a movie. Yeah, very alone in the outback. Yeah, quite, I mean, of course, not that alone, with the 200 crew.
It was amazing, amazing track to cut. It was one of those sessions where you felt that maybe you'd cut the ultimate rock and roll song. I mean, which is odd, you never do, but it had that that enthusiasm about it.
Brown Sugar, I mean, you know, it's typical Mick lyric, isn't it, that? Take it either way. It's very clever, and that's what he's great at.
Well, if I had to take one song, I suppose it'd be Brown Sugar if I was taking it away with me and I couldn't take any others. Because, I don't know, it's the most successful and it's, like, close to my heart.
It would work in all kinds of... no matter how you felt if you were alone on a desert island, for instance. Other ones might, like, bring me really down, you know? I mean, Sister Morphine, can you imagine?